I can't tell you how desperately I want to be your pastor. I can't tell you how bad I want New Birth to be your church. I want to be your pastor. I want New Birth to be your church.
Be at this altar. I want to be your pastor.
I want New Birth to be your church. I want to be your pastor.
I'm going to tell you, I want to be your pastor.
I'm telling you straight up, I want to be your pastor. I want to be your pastor. I want Jesus to be your Lord. I want New Birth to be your church. I want to tell you this, I want to be your pastor for the rest of your life. Come quickly, please. I want to be your pastor. I want you to come meet me at this altar. I want to be your pastor.
I want to be your pastor.
I want to be your pastor. I want to be your pastor. I need you to hear from me. I want New Birth to be your church.
Hey family, I'm Diallo.
And I'm Brittany.
Exciting events are unfolding throughout this special month, and we're thrilled to share them with you. So remember, for additional information, simply scan the QR code located on the back of a chair in the sanctuary.
Thank you for your support and donations to the American Red Cross Blood Drive last week. One donation can save up to 3 lives. Our goal was to collect 20 pints. We collected over 33 pints, so approximately 100 people will receive the gift of life because of you. New Birth saves lives. Our Circle with the Sisters gathering on Monday, March 25th is going to be spectacular and exclusive, as it will not be televised. Ladies, we're inviting you to an evening of entertainment, encouragement, and education. We will be hosting an exclusive screening of the new award-winning documentary, Sisters Getting Well, about the healing power of community. Afterwards, the filmmakers Brandy Harvey and Jacqueline Glass will join Dr. Carrie Turner for a live enriching conversation. This event will not be broadcasted. You must attend in person. See you there, ladies.
Easter 2024 is gonna be big at New Birth. We're bringing the city together. Join us on Good Friday night, March 29th, 7:30 p.m. as New Birth and World Changers unite for a monumental celebration with special guest Dr. Creflo Dollar.
Now, I am not enough, but Jesus is, and I've got to have Jesus, and in Him I am more than enough.
Dr. Jamal Bryant and the electrifying New Birth worship team will lead us in a powerful service you won't forget, and the celebration won't stop there. Resurrection Sunday, March 31st, will feature a soul-stirring worship led by Todd Delaney. Moving Easter message from Dr. Bryant.
But when you get to the place where you're empty, God will say, let me fill you.
It's a weekend of worship, praise, and community as Atlanta comes together to celebrate our risen Savior, Jesus Christ. Easter weekend at New Birth. Don't miss it.
New Birth family, as we embark on our Show Me a Sign capital campaign, we embrace a season of divine revelation. It's time to enhance the beauty of the signs around the exterior of our campus for the first time in over 2 decades, reflecting our inner transformation. We invite you to join us in sowing seeds that beautify our church grounds and in return, seek God's direction in your life for the upcoming quarter. With giving tiers from $100 to $5,000, we ask that you pray for guidance on your contribution level. Let's unite on April 21st to raise $250,000, honoring the land entrusted to us by the Lord. Together as we give, we anticipate the signs and wonders God will reveal in our midst.
What's up, family? I am Broderick McBride, the Director for Emerging Generations here at New Birth Cathedral. Parents, I have some exciting news for you. Catapult Summer Academy 2024 is underway. If you have a child between the ages of 5 and 12 years of age and you are looking to find them something to do this summer, this is the summer experience you want to sign them up for. Parents, go over to our website now. Fill out the interest form, and we will be following up with you first regarding our application process. We want to see you there. Take care.
If it's your first time here, welcome.
We hope you enjoy this service. If you need anything, ask any of our ministry workers and they'll point you in the right direction.
At the end of service, you'll have an opportunity to connect further with us, whether by making Jesus the Lord of your life or becoming a member at New Birth.
Remember, here at New Birth, our vision is simple.
Equip, empower, engage.
See you next week.
But I tell you, draw on his anointing. Don't just catch what he's saying. Pull out of his spirit like you ain't never pulled before.
The nightmare's over. The crying is over.
Dr. Jamal Harrison Bryant is a prominent African-American pastor and author known for his dynamic preaching style and involvement in social and political activism. Born on May 21st, 1971 in Boston, Massachusetts, he is the son of Bishop John Richard Bryant and Reverend Cecilia Williams Bryant, which placed him in a religious environment from an early age. Dr. Bryant attended Morehouse College, where he earned a Bachelor of Arts degree in Political Science and International Studies. He later pursued a Master of Divinity degree at Duke University and continued his education at the Graduate Theological Foundation, where he received his Doctorate of Ministry. In 2000, Dr. Bryant founded the Empowerment Temple AME Church in Baltimore, Maryland, which rapidly grew under his leadership to thousands of members. His sermons and services often addressed issues such as social justice, civil rights, and empowerment, particularly within the African American community. Dr. Bryant has been involved in various forms of activism, including participating in protests and working on initiatives to address systemic issues like police brutality, poverty, and voter suppression. His outspoken approach has placed him at the forefront of contemporary civil rights conversations. Bryant is also known for his media presence, including television broadcasts of his services and active use of social media platforms to reach a broader audience with his messages. As God would have it, in late 2018, Jamal Bryant was announced as the new senior pastor of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church in Stonecrest, Georgia, succeeding the late Bishop Eddie L. Long. Since taking over New Birth, Dr. Bryant has focused on both spiritual leadership and community outreach, continuing his advocacy work. This work includes over 1 million people fed via the King's Table, thousands of people making the decision to follow Christ or join New Birth, nearly 1,000 baptized, and expanding New Birth's digital reach, opening a brand new medical clinic, housing a new African textile museum, and the vision to build a vibrant residential community for those looking to change the trajectory of their futures. Amongst this, with his acumen and wise counsel, and most certainly New Birth's generous members, Dr. Bryant has financially steered New Birth away from the darkness of debt and despair into the buoyancy of hope by virtually cutting the debt in half from $32 million to less than $16 million. His work and progress is impossible to ignore. For this reason, he has been acknowledged by every local municipality in the local Atlanta Metroplex, the state of Georgia, the President of the United States, and the United Nations. Today, we pause and give reverence to God for the gift, the set angel of this house, Dr. Jamal Harrison Bryant.
Thank you. not be seen.
Family, let's clap our hands and give God glory and all the praise, all of the honor. Hey, this is a special day. It is the fifth year that we all get to say Dr. Jamal Bryant is our pastor and our lead shepherd. We are so grateful for what God is doing in his life. Listen, when you walked into the room, you received a pen and you received a card. If you have one in your hand, just wave it even now. Just wave it. Let me see that you have one. If you love Dr. Bryant, will you just do me a favor? Will you make some noise in the sanctuary? Will you celebrate God online? Hey, listen, we want you to write a special note to him, acknowledging him, thanking God for him, sending a prayer for him, and sowing even a seed into his life, just to let him know how good God has been to you because of the gift that God gave you through him. This is a season of grace. Someone shout grace. It's a season where it is not earned, it is not deserved, it is God's unmerited favor. And we are believing that as God blesses this man of God, he's going to bless you also. If you're walking in the same grace that God has on your leader, will you just give God praise, glory, and honor?
Somebody ought to use your voice in the building and shout out praise. Come on, I can't hear your new word. One twist grace.
The grace to build. He is a builder. And over these past 5 years, we have experienced him building up this congregation. Every day he prays for us. Every week he gives us word that is relevant and powerful. We've watched him build our community by building a museum, by building a medical clinic, by building people, by giving them food. We've watched him build relationships with civic leaders, so much so that he was invited to both the U.S. Capitol and the Georgia State Capitol within a week. We've watched God build not only our community and our church through him, but also the nations. He was recently given the nobility title by a Cameroonian chief of Nakim, which means builder of nations. He has the grace to build.
Come on, Newport, everybody shout out grace.
Grace.
I can't hear you, church. Wondrous grace.
Wondrous grace.
Just one more time, everybody use your voice and shout out grace.
Grace.
Hey, wondrous grace.
The beauty of grace in a shepherd is that a shepherd protects sheep even when the sheep don't protect themselves. And it's the grace that our pastor has to protect us. He's protected us for 5 years when the sheep didn't know how to protect themselves. He covers us in prayer and intercession, and you feel the protection not just on Sunday, but you feel it on Monday, you feel it on Tuesday, you feel it all through the week. He tells us every time we get ready to walk out, lift your hands as high as you see yourself going. He's protecting us from low ambition. He puts us in the place that he makes us lift our eyes up to the hills from whence cometh our help. All of us have been protected by the grace of our senior pastor. If you know that you've been protected by this shepherd, shout, God, thank you for protection. It's the grace to protect.
Come on, Newburgh, everybody say grace.
Grace.
I can't hear you in the building. Wondrous grace.
Verse
anniversary for our pastor. We are believing God for extra grace of influence. We are believing that the Lord is going to place his name at the top of the seven mountains of influence. And there will be no room, no environment, no community that he cannot walk into and shift the environment of the space. We are believing that the angels of the Lord even now are taking his name in the winds of the Holy Spirit from the four corners of the earth and spreading his name throughout the globe, that as he moves under the unction of the Holy Spirit, that the wind of the Lord will empower him with influence to change nations all over this world. If you believe that our pastor has the influence of grace, look at somebody and say, influence of grace this morning. Hallelujah. Earlier in our service, Pastor Lemon shared with you that we want to take a minute today and just tell him thank you for all that he has done for each of us in serving us as pastor. I want you to take this moment right now with your cards, if you've written on it. We open the altar for you to lay your card on the altar even right now so that our pastor will know how much you love him in moments of happiness and moments of sadness. He can pick up those cards and know how much you mean to him. Listen, today we are believing God for greater grace in every area of his life this morning. You may now come to the altar.
Come on, everybody say, grace. Hey, wondrous grace.
You. So glad to be with you this morning. Let's praise him.
God cares. Elijah May said, why run a race just to come in second place? New birth, whatever we're in, we always come first. And this sign is the last of what we used to be. A couple of months ago, a driver lost control, ran into this sign, and the LED wall became on the blitz. God gave me a vision. Show me a sign. I'm going to replace all of the signs that are on our campus so that they are exemplary of the spirit of excellence that our church represents and exudes. I can't do it without your help, without your partnership, and without your buy-in.
It's time to enhance the beauty of the signs around the exterior of our campus for the first time in over two decades, reflecting our inner transformation. We invite you to join us in sowing seeds that beautify our church grounds and in return, seek God's direction in your life for the upcoming quarter. With giving tiers from $100 to $5,000, we ask that you pray for guidance on your contribution level. Let's unite on April 21st to raise $250,000, honoring the land entrusted to us by the Lord. Together as we give, we anticipate the signs and wonders God will reveal in our midst.
Bless the Lord. Would you join me in giving God glory? Come on, let's thank God for what God has done today.
Down through the years, God has been so good to us. Hallelujah. I want every person standing, if you're physically able to do it, I want you to stand. This is a day of celebration for me. I am just so grateful to be in relationship with you. I can't get to all of you. And so I need you to just spread the love for me. Spread the love for me. I need you to just embrace three people around you and tell them, I'm so glad you're here today. I'm so glad. Hallelujah. I just want to thank you. And ever. For all you've done for me. Come on, clap that hand. Blessing.
Blessing and glory and honor, they all belong to you.
Come on, thank you. Come on, one more time, everybody, real big. I just want to thank you. Just want to thank you.
Forever and ever.
And ever. For all you've done for me. Come on, blessings and glory. Blessings. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, I dare you to lift that hand up. I just want to lift you. Come on, I just want to lift you. Just want to lift. And ever. And ever. For all you've done for me. Come on, lift him up. Come on. Blessing. Listen, I need you to do me a favor. I just need to make one edit. I'm appreciative for our pastors on today, for our choir, our media ministry, who have really appreciated me on today. But the truth of the matter is we wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the grace of God. And I need you to do me a favor. I'm just a vessel, just an instrument. He could have used anybody to get his will done. Can you do me a favor? Can we give God glory for being with New Birth for the last 5 years? Come on, you got to do better than that. Who couldn't serve a God like our God? Bless his name. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. This has been the greatest honor of my life over the last 5 years. I am able to boast the claim that I'm the pastor of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church. I'm telling you, it is... an amazing privilege, it's an amazing honor. I hope that you'll yield to me just a few moments of reflection. 5 years ago, I had no idea what it is that God had in mind or in store for my life. 156 people thought they were going to be the pastor of New Birth Missionary Baptist Church. I mean, 156 of them thought that they were going to do it. And they were in position until the 157th one showed up. Amen. And I was the last one to the party. But I want to take a moment because I've not had an opportunity to do so. The process of those who really helped to form it. Our apostle died, Bishop Eddie Long. I want to thank God for the foundation. I didn't start with nothing. Come on now. This building that we're in, the vision that we are carrying out. I want to thank God for him. I want to thank God for his amazing wife who stood with him, Lady Vanessa Long. I'm appreciative. I'm grateful. I think that we will be absent, and I will not let history ignore the leadership lent to us by Pastor Carla Stokes while... Come on. Let's thank God for Leadership Matters. I'm thankful for her light and for her life. And after our bishop transitioned and we went through a season of transition, I would be derelict if I did not thank God for the life and for the legacy of Brother Tommy Dortch, who was the chairman of our board, who really helped navigate and to steer our church through choppy waters. You may be seated. They converged a search committee to make sure that they scoured the earth looking for an appropriate person. Our vice chair of our board is Brother Mike Roberts out of St. Louis, Missouri. And they pulled together a committee to really look through and to make sure that they did their due diligence to go through 156 applications. That's a lot of work. 156 applications, and I want to thank God for chairman of our deacon board, Elder Stanback. Thank you so very much. I'm indebted. Amen. Let's give God some glory for him. I honor you, sir. Thank you so very much. And Brother Maurice Waddell and Elder Mary Hill, come on, give God some praise. They were working the night shift to get it done. And I'm telling you, I'm thankful for all of the people that I mentioned. All the people that I mentioned, I'm thankful for. But there was a sister on that search committee who was my cheerleader without pom-poms. And I got to thank God for Sister Flossie, who is, that's, amen, such an amazing gift. Thank you for believing in me. Thank you for that vote of confidence. I had no idea where God was taking me or where it was supposed to happen. I was in Atlanta, that's June of 2018. I was in Atlanta for an AME convention. I was in Atlanta for an AME convention and got to the hotel and bumped into Bishop Neil Ellis, who was checking into the hotel. And I asked Bishop Ellis, what was he doing at the AME convention? And he said, I ain't here for no AME convention. I says, I'm here. They just asked me to fly in to help lead New Birth and finding a pastor. I said, oh, that's great. He says, I want you to just come preach for me one Sunday until I find a pastor. I said, oh, no, I'm not coming to preach on no Sunday. He said, no, I really need you to do it for me. And I said, okay. He said, when is the next free Sunday you have? I said, the last Sunday in September 2018. He said, all right, put that down. You are coming to preach. He called me that night and said, it's Youth Day. I said, Lord, it's Youth Day. He said, can you handle it? I said, I can handle it. It's okay. He said, now get it out of your head. He said, don't even think about it. The next pastor of New Birth got to be married, so you are not qualified. I said, I wasn't even thinking about it. I wasn't even thinking about it. Lying. And fast forward 3 months later, Elder Stanback and Bishop Ellis called me on the phone, I want to say the second Thursday in November of 2018, to tell me I had been duly elected unanimously to become the pastor of this church. And I had Elder Stanback got off the phone. He was on travel for business. Elder Stanback got off the phone. It's just me and Bishop Ellis on the phone. And I said, hold on, you got to click over because we got to call my dad. He said, no, no, you can call him. I said, no. You got to stay on the phone to tell him I'm going to a Baptist church. And so we clicked over, got my dad on the phone. And I came here December 8th, 2018. And it wasn't until December 11th, 2018 that I had my first meeting with Elder Waddell and Brother Adolphus in December 11th after I sold my house in Baltimore and left my church in Baltimore. December 11th is when they told me we had $32 million in debt. It was, yeah. I already preached my first Sunday here, and it was December 12th, Brother Tommy Deutsch called me and said, you know everything I promised you as the pastor? I said, yes, I know everything that you promised me. He says, we're going to do it, just not yet. We're going to do it, just not yet. And what you all don't know is my first three months living here, I was living in the Embassy Suites. I was living in the Embassy Suites Hotel, eating free breakfast every morning from 6 to 10. And I was asking God, are you sure this where you want me to be? At Embassy Suites. And I want you to know, if you suffer with him, oh, come on. Some of y'all ain't never had to suffer with him. Weeping can only endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. And I wanted you to know that because a whole lot of you have a misperception from watching Greenleaf. You think all kinds of things are happening. That they living in a mansion and driving a Rolls Royce, and that is not the case. But I am telling you, I promise to God, as I'm standing in this church, this is the happiest I have ever been in my life. I'm telling you, it's the happiest I have ever been in my life. And I am so grateful. After following Jesus Christ, the best thing I could have ever done is move to Atlanta, Georgia. And I wanted to say to you, I say to you often, but I want to say it to you today. Thank you for letting me be your pastor. Thank you so very much. So very much. When I came, one of my greatest fears was being away from my girls. And at that time, my twins were in the eighth grade when I came. Angel and Adore, y'all, come on. Come on. They were in the eighth. Now they passed me. Yes. And both of them are graduating from high school in 2 months. And they have chosen sides. Adore is going to Hampton University following her mother's footsteps. And Angel is coming to Spelman College. Be with her dad. And Grace, who is the leader of the tribe, was supposed to be with us today, and she is in Miami on spring break. Please. Everybody had 6 a.m. flights, and two of them made their flight. And y'all pray for Grace, and Grace is living up to her name on today. Thank y'all. I just wanted y'all to see him. Thank you so very much. Because not just in taking care of me, you take care of my children. You take care of my family. And I don't take that lightly, and I don't take it for granted. I'm appreciative for the support of my parents who have prayed me through these 5 years. Prayed me through these 5 years. The the first Sunday of March in closed doors. I met with my leaders right before we came out for communion service and told them to pray for my mother, who had a stage 2 of breast cancer. And they took her to the doctor this week, and the doctor exclaimed they didn't know what was happening, but they couldn't find one cancer cell. Come. If y'all don't give God glory over that, this is the year of answered prayer. And so I'm thankful. You better be selfish for yourself. If you know you serve a God who is a body healer, I dare you to open up your mouth. Bless the Lord. You may be seated. I need you to just spread a rumor down your road. Tell them he's a healer. Come on, I dare to tell somebody he healed my body and he told me to run on. When I think of the goodness of Jesus and all he's done, we gotta move.
Be the glory.
Come on. Be seated. We got to move, Jonathan. We got a whole service ahead of us. You may be seated. We overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of the testimony. It is no secret what God can do. What is done for others, he'll do it for you. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Listen, when my mother was first diagnosed, she swore the whole family, don't tell nobody, we just gonna keep it in the family. Hallelujah. But when God healed her body, that ain't your decision. You owe God a praise. Come on, I can't hear nobody. And too many of y'all are sitting on your testimony. If God did something for you in private, I
need you to shout about it in public. I need you to give God glory.
You may be seated. I don't know what's wrong with y'all today. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. We've come a long way from the last 5 years, and I want you to know how good God has been to us over these 5 years. When I came, I shared with you moments ago, we were at $32 million worth of debt. And as of today, we are down to $13 million. Come on, I need you to give God glory for that. Amen. 5 years ago, we didn't have a full medical clinic on our campus. 5 years ago, we hadn't fed 1 million people in the middle of the pandemic. 5 years ago, we didn't even have plans to build 150 houses right on our campus. I want you to dream with me for just one moment. I want you to dream with me for just one moment. Where you think God gonna have us 5 years from now? Come on, I said, where do you think? What eyes haven't seen and what ears haven't heard? Together, we were able to sojourn through COVID-19 while we were virtual for literally almost 2 years. And I'm grateful that God kept us together and we've been able to walk together and work together and build together. How it is that we've been able to do this level of exploits for the kingdom is through the grace of God, through the prayers of our intercessors, and because you have seen the vision and you've sown into it. If over the last 5 years you've been tithing into this house, would you give God glory if you've been come on, where are the tithers in this place? If you've seen God multiply your seed and do something sizable, substantive, and significant, then you ought to be excited about it. 5 years later, I'm in the same position as I was 5 years ago, and that is you can't beat God's giving. No matter how hard you try. And so I want you to partner with me. Our servant leaders, our ushers are moving amongst you. If you're absent of an envelope, would you lift up that hand, please? You're absent of an envelope. I want you to lift up that hand. I don't want you absent of the opportunity to sow, absent of the opportunity to give. A five-year return on a seed shows that God can silence the mouth of the enemy. The bank didn't even think we were going to be open. Y'all ain't saying nothing. The county didn't even think we were going to be open. People in your family didn't think we were going to be open. But God said, upon this rock I'll build my church, and the very gates of hell will not prevail against it. I want every person sowing. I want every person giving, every person sharing. Glad to have our comrades from Palestine with us on today. Honored, sir, to have you with us in worship. Every person is sowing. Every person is sharing. Every person is giving. Pastor, what must I render unto God for all these blessings? God made everything, and everything belongs to him. He told you, you don't even have to guess about what you ought to give. You ought to give your obedience. Your obedience is greater than your sacrifice. He's challenging all of us to give 10% back into the house of God. And I want all of us in this day to be operating in lockstep. This is the Sunday, the third Sunday of every month is when we tithe together as a family. We're mindful that while we were yet sinners, he died for us. And because of that, we give God glory, we give him honor, and we give him praise. If you have filled out your offering envelope, all of our giving options are available to you on the screen. Whether you're giving through Zelle or Givelify, PushPay or Text to Give, you're writing out a check, you're writing it out to New Birth. Those of you who are online from around the world, in Savannah, in Augusta, in Charleston, in Columbia, in Bowie, whether you are in Cleveland, you're in San Francisco, in Kansas City, wherever it is, you're in the Bahamas, you're in South Africa, you're in Louisiana, I want you partnering with us on today. We are a local church making a global impact, and we're only able to do it with your partnership and with your participation. Every person, would you lift up your seed above your head? Every person, lift up that seed above your head. Your gift ought to be bigger than you. Your gift is going to go further than you. Your gift is going to do the work for you. I want you to repeat after me, Lord, thank you for what you did last year. Let me stop. Let's start all over again. Lord, thank you for what you did over the last 5 years. Thank you for what you did over the last 5 months. Thank you for what you did over the last 5 weeks. But the seed in my hand is in expectation for what you're going to do in the next 5 days. In Jesus' name, amen. Bless the Lord. Our servant leaders, they're moving amongst you. If you feel so compelled and you want to sow your seed on the altar, you're able to do so. Before I came up today, they shared with you a video that I really want to reinforce. The third Sunday in April is our Show Me a Sign Sunday. Show Me a Sign Sunday. We want to refurbish and replace all of the signs on our sanctuary campus. We are believing and expecting God for a gift of $250,000 on one Sunday above our tithes. $250,000 above our tithes on the third Sunday in April. And I'm believing by faith that we're going to be able to do it. We pray that you're partnering about what is the tier that you're going to give. I'm going to lead that Sunday with a seed of $5,000. Those of you that can give a $2,500, $1,500, $500 or even $100. This is above your tithes, but I want every person sowing. I want every person sharing. I want every person giving, because I'm believing that God is going to send thousands in our direction. And when they come onto our campus, I want them to see a clear sign that this is a five-star ministry, doing five-star work, doing what it is that God represents in the spirit of excellence. Would you do me a favor? Would you give your attention to our screen as we share our guest for today?
We are thrilled to celebrate 5 years of Dr. Bryant's trailblazing pastoral leadership. Our guest speaker today is Dr. Dana Carson, the apostle and senior pastor of Reflections of Christ's Kingdom World Outreach International. The ROC is a worldwide organization of Bible-centered, spirit-filled, community-building, and kingdom-minded churches headquartered in Houston, Texas. Dr. Dana Carson is one of the nation's foremost kingdom theologians and down-to-earth pastors whose radical message and raw delivery are known all over the world. He's planted churches in North America, Africa, Europe, and Asia. Although he was a high school dropout from Chicago, Dr. Carson has earned 3 doctorates and 4 master's degrees, making him one of the top 1% of African-American scholars in the U.S. Dr. Carson also holds several executive certifications from MIT, Northwestern, Kellogg, and Columbia. Dr. Carson is also a member of the distinguished Kappa Alpha Psi Fraternity Incorporated. Dr. Dana Carson is a prolific scholar, author with more than 240 plus books, and is also a dynamic and globally renowned speaker whose messages have been broadcast on TBN, BET, Daystar, and the
Word Network. Dr. Carson is a devoted husband to Rochelle Carson, who serves faithfully in ministry with him, and they have been blessed with 5 children. Before he comes back to bless us in the Word, we'll bring back Kathy Taylor. Kathy Taylor is an acclaimed gospel singer, songwriter, and minister of music, known for her dynamic vocal delivery and powerful live performances. Her spirited and soulful style has made her a beloved figure in the gospel music community. Taylor has served as a minister of music at the Windsor Village United Methodist Church in Houston, Texas, and she has worked with noted gospel music figures, including the late Reverend James Cleveland. She is known for hits such as Oh How Precious, which blessed us greatly earlier, and I Can't Thank Him Enough. Throughout her career, Taylor has been recognized for her contributions to gospel music with awards and nominations, and she continues to inspire audiences with her ministry and music. New Birth, please welcome back Kathy Taylor.
Praise the Lord, saints. Praise the Lord, saints. Dr. Brian, I just want to say happy 5th anniversary, and what a marvelous job you've done, not only here, but in the world. We see you and we love you. God bless you. Just want to remind you that God is with you. Sometimes life can change suddenly, and you find it hard to even breathe. So used to being strong, now sometimes barely hanging on. Y'all, we've gotta stand tall, or too many would fall. What would people say if they knew I felt this way? Then God gave me this refrain, and I'll never be the same. He reminded me that he would always be with us. God is with us.
God is with us.
No, I'll be with you always.
God is with us.
I'll stay closer than a brother.
God is with us.
You've got to know
God is with us.
bones wither. Y'all, that's good news this morning. God is with us. Say, Master, the tempest is raging, the billows are tall, sing high, the sky is overshadowed with blackness, but this God is with me.
God is with me.
So whatever my light the hour has taught me say, it is well, it is well, because God is with us. Somebody ought to help me say, God is with us. Together.
God is with
Hallelujah. Come on, clap those hands and give God glory. Give God the glory. For this is a day that the Lord has made, and we will rejoice in his name. For the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run therein and are safe. You may be seated in the name of the Lord. Greetings, New Birth. It's such a blessing and an honor to be here on this morning, especially for this auspicious occasion of celebrating God by celebrating God's divine choice of leadership, Pastor Dr. Jamal Bryant. When we lift God's man up, we're lifting God up because he's God's choice. Come on, let's give him a round of applause. He wasn't by accident, he was on purpose. Amen. Well, listen, I'm going to move as expeditiously as possible so that I can be in order concerning our time. But I want to thank all of the leaders, all of the board members, the deacons and administration and the staff that has shown me and some of my staff members that are with me such great hospitality. Thank you so very, very much. If you would, turn with me now to the book of Romans. The book of Romans. Romans chapter 10. Romans chapter 10. I want you to know I've brought some books with me that I believe that will bless you. I'm not going to take time to announce them, but we have them out at the table. Those of you that may be familiar with my ministry, my bailiwick is the kingdom of God in its Jewish context, Second Temple Judaism context, and I've written over 240 books, but we brought some with us, and so please avail yourself to them. They will bless your life. Romans chapter 10, beginning at verse 14, reading through verse 17. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the gospel of peace, who bring glad tidings of good things. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed our report? So then faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of the Lord. And this is the word of the Lord. You may be seated. Today I want to look at this text and I want to talk for a title. Let's talk about the preacher, everyone else is. Let's talk about the preacher, everyone else is. This year, Christianity Today published an article entitled Above Reproach. And they said, fewer Americans see pastors as ethical. The country's perception of clergy hit an all-time low based on the Gallup poll, with fewer than one-third of Americans rating clergy as highly honest and ethical. People are more likely, they said in the article, to believe in the moral standards held by nurses, police officers, and chiropractors than religious leaders. Clergy were still more trusted, though, than politicians, lawyers, and journalists. Now, when I was a child, I was taught to respect the preacher. In fact, I remember as a child growing up, there was a young child preacher who was my age, and he was my age, but we had to call him Reverend. We had to respect him, even though he was our age. Our parents taught us to respect the preacher. But today, while we discover there's a growing distrust and disinterest in preachers, without the preacher, the gospel will not be preached. There is a correlation between the disinterest and the distrust in the preacher and also the spiritual apathy and lethargy that exists in our country as it relates to Christianity. While this nation was thought to be built upon Judeo-Christian beliefs and values that reflect what I call in one of my books, The Five Watersheds of History and Theology, Watershed Theology of Colonization, that was established in 1701 by the Society of the Propagation of the Gospel in foreign parts, trying to console and compromise in order to get Christianity accepted in the colonies. We've discovered that this theology of the West has created a mess in North America. And in North America, we're facing a Christian crisis. North America, we've been reclassified as a post-Christian nation. And as a post-Christian nation, it means people consider themselves Christians and or spiritual without facilitating the Bible. People attend church but operate independent of the scriptures. And there's only one level left, and that's neo-pagan. And that's where people no longer believe the Bible and believe that God is necessary. Now, when we consider what's happening as the American culture increasingly becomes more pluralistic and post-Christian, the preacher becomes less attractive. The world has this love-hate relationship with the preacher. When you hear people talk about the preacher on the cut, it's almost embarrassing to say that I'm a preacher today. But I want to say this morning, regardless of how unnecessary you may feel that the preacher is, whenever God gets ready to do anything, the first thing he does is assigns a preacher. The scriptures declare that the eyes of the Lord are looking, roaming upon the earth and looking for someone to stand in the gap, looking for the preacher. The first human introduced to the physical world was a preacher, Adam. And Adam preached to the animals, nature, and Eve. God chose to speak to Adam, and he chose to speak to Eve through Adam. Now, you may be asking, why didn't he choose to just speak directly to Eve? And the answer is he's sovereign. God does what God wants to do, how he wants to do it, to whom he wants to do it to, whenever he wants to do it. And he doesn't need the permission of anyone nor the vote of a committee to decide his actions, because he's autonomous and he's God all by himself. And he chose to preach, a preacher. The very first human being was a preacher. Adam preached the will of God to all of creation. Using the preacher,
is God's methodology. Thus, the first two models of human existence evolved or revolved around the concept and the construct of preaching. Adam and then Noah. Adam was a preacher. Even though he was a falling preacher, he was a preacher. And he preached before and after the fall. We see that because Abel offered God acceptable sacrifices, and Abel was not in the garden. And so Adam continued to preach even after the fall. Then we see Noah. Noah is a preacher of righteousness. And all of creation except for eight souls ignored the preaching assignment of Noah. And thus, Noah preached, and he was the only one God told about the coming flood. Because when God gets ready to do something, he tells the preacher. Unfortunately, everyone believes that they get the intel of the preacher, but everyone doesn't get the intel of the preacher. God said about Moses, he says that when I talk to Moses, I talk to him face to face. God talks to the preacher. And I want you to know the preacher is God's choice. Those who believed in the ministry of Noah or the preaching of Noah was eight, and they were saved. The preacher is the preferred mouthpiece of God. God called Abram to believe, but he called Moses to preach. Israel knew the Decalogue because of Moses. Moses preaching was what allowed them to walk in covenant with God. God called Joshua to preach, and Joshua was entrusted with the word of the Lord. And God told Joshua that this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth. He says you're to meditate on it both day and night so that you can do all that is according in the book. In essence, he called Joshua to preach. God stated to Joshua that Moses, my servant, is dead. And then he told him to get up and to take and lead this people across to the promised land. And it's important here, something. It says that Moses, my servant, is dead. Joshua was a preacher. Moses was his predecessor. But God made sure that Joshua didn't get lost in the call of Moses. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. I'm not calling you to be Moses. I'm calling you to be Joshua. But just as I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. Sometimes one of the most difficult things to do as a preacher, especially when you follow another preacher, is to be yourself. And aren't you glad today that even though Moses was great, but Joshua didn't have to try to be Moses. He could flow in his own anointing. Aren't you glad today that even though Bishop Eddie Long was great, that Pastor Jamal Bryant doesn't have to try to operate in his flow? Aren't you glad today to know that if God did all what he did with Bishop Long during his tenure, just imagine what God's going to do with Joshua in his tenure. Aren't you glad? Come on, somebody say, thank God for Joshua. Even though Moses was great. Even though Moses was great. And we thank God today for your Joshua. Your pastor is not your old pastor. He has a new assignment. and he has another personality. He has a different set of gifts. He has a different temperament. He has a different approach. But let me tell you, his approach is relevant because Moses brought you here, but Joshua took you there. And it's important to understand to allow the preacher to be the preacher. Come on, somebody say, thank God for our preacher. I'm simply talking about the preacher. The preacher is the wisdom of God transmitted and personified through oral communication. God reveals himself to you through the preacher. Jeremiah states that God said, I will give you shepherds after my own heart, and they will feed you with knowledge and understanding. Knowledge is what you learn and know, and understanding is the ability to implement what you've learned. And so God said that I'm going to take you to a higher level in your life, and I'm going to make it plain to you by sending you a shepherd. The greatest thing God could do for you, the greatest gift God could ever give to you, is a shepherd. A shepherd is a gift from the heart of God. He says, I will give you shepherds after my own heart. And so when you think about the preacher is God's love note to you. It is God's way of saying, I love you. I love you so much, I'm going to give you the preacher, because the preacher is going to come out of my heart, and he's going to have my knowledge, and he's going to teach you understanding. Preachers can be seen like parents in that kids don't recognize their wisdom until they grow up. The preacher empowers you to walk not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sit in the seat of the scornful. Somebody say, thank God for the preacher. The preacher is so important that we have a book that is known as the preacher, Solomon and Ecclesiastes. The Hebrew title is Koheleth. The Koheleth only found in Ecclesiastes, the word, and it comes from the Hebrew word gahal. Gahal means assembly. Those terms mean one who addresses an assembly, a preacher. The Septuagint, which is the Greek version of the Hebrew Bible, uses the word ekklesia, which means assembly, congregation, or church, but simply means preacher or one who speaks before an assembly. The preacher is so important that we have a book that's referred to as the preacher, or one who speaks before the assembly. The preacher is not just an ordinary person, but has to be divinely called and commissioned for the assignment. The preacher is not just like everyone else. The preacher is not just common nor normal. He's a man with a divine touch, with a divine assignment sent by a divine God. I'm just talking about the preacher. The preacher is called the man of God. And in Greek, we call it a genitive, which means he's the possession of God. The man of God belongs to God. God calls him his personal possession. Therefore, God gets real touchy and sensitive when you mess with the man of God. And that's the reason he says, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm, because they belong to me. And when they mess up, I fix them. I get them together. They're my responsibility. You know how it is. Other people don't just whip your children. You whip your own children. You take care of what's yours. God says, I'll take care of what's mine. And you have to understand, your job is not to get the preacher straight. The preacher's job is to get you straight. I'm just talking about the preacher. The preacher can be very, he can be an adjutant, you know, because their ministry is the ministry of agitation and aggravation. They cause you to be uncomfortable, because when you're comfortable, you don't change. And so it's the preacher job to get you squirming into your seat. It's the preacher job to get you like, oh God. It's the preacher's job to upset you, to irritate and to aggravate you to such a degree that you say, I've got to change. And if the preacher can't preach you to aggravation and irritation, then you're never going to change. And the problem with that is God is calling you to change, and then to change, and then to change. And so every time you gather and you come hear the preacher is here so that you can become more what God wants you to become, so that the blessings of God are released in your life. The preacher is God's possession, thus he's called and he's commissioned to deliver God's message to you. Paul refers to the preacher as the presbuo, which means ambassador. Christ, he talks about it in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, saying that we are ambassadors, which means we represent our king from a foreign language. And it is, Paul says, as God was in Christ reconciling the world back unto himself, Christ is in us reconciling the world back unto God. The preacher job is to connect you back with God. And without the preacher, there is no connection. We have this ideology and theology today that I don't need God, I don't need the church, I don't need the preacher, all I need is my Bible. Well, listen, why didn't you say that about your calculus book? Why didn't you say that about your law book? Why you needed a professor? And you can't just pick up this book and just read it. This book is rooted in a context that is very different than your context. And you have to understand the context if you're going to understand the content. And if you don't understand the context, you're going to misinterpret the content. And if you misinterpret the content, you're going to go astray. And so you need the preacher to rightly divide the word of truth. You need the preacher to be able to clearly explain and give you the rule of God so that you can connect to God. Somebody say, thank God for the preacher. Yeah. The preacher is to share the will of God, which is considered good news. Because when you hear the will of God and you get in the will of God, it brings the blessings of God to your life. So the preacher is extremely important. The preacher is called. See, the preacher didn't just go. It's being a preacher is not a vocation. It's not a career choice. You can't just say, I like that and I think I can do that. It's not because you possess oratorical skills. You have to be sent. You have to have an assignment. You can't be good, you gotta be anointed. I'm gonna say it again, you can't be good, you gotta be anointed. And if the anointing of or the rub of God is on your life, people can sense that. And it is the anointing that destroys the yoke. So, they that preach the gospel, they live of the gospel. When you're called to preach the gospel, it is the gospel that takes care of your life. They that preach the gospel shall live of the gospel. There is a lot of rhetoric articulated in churches and social media today about preachers and money. Well, when you preach, you're supposed to live of the gospel. That's your livelihood. And so we don't brag about preaching and not taking an offering or not taking a salary. I'm saying the preacher, the Bible says, they that preach the gospel shall live of the gospel. So my income is demonstrative of my ministry. And so if my ministry is successful, Jesus told the disciples, don't take nothing with you. See, that's one of the problems today. Everybody's taking something with them, so they have an option. They have an alternative. But if you got to preach off of the anointing that's on your life, and that anointing has to be appreciated by people you help, and those people then sow into your life, you've got to have an anointed ministry. Because if you don't touch nobody, you ain't getting nobody. If you don't touch nobody, ain't nobody going to take care of you. But Jesus said, all you have to do is go and preach the gospel, and folk will take care of your life. I'm just talking about the preacher. Noah was a preacher, and he was called. Moses was called. Jeremiah, Elijah, Elisha were called. One of the greatest demonstrations of the preacher being called is Isaiah. And Isaiah's call is so picturesque in Hebrew that it really helps us to understand the preacher. And in fact, our text is rooted in the prophecies of Isaiah. And Isaiah shows us a call because it says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Isaiah was in the temple mourning, and he had an experience with God. And he saw God high and lifted up above everything. And this experience with Isaiah led to Isaiah's conviction. He says, I'm a man of unclean lips, and it led to his confession. He confessed based on his conviction that he saw God like he had never seen God before. He got a glimpse of God the way that other people did not get a glimpse of God. He saw him as the king, and he saw only the train of his robe. And then he confessed, and then he says, but I also live in a nation with men of unclean lips. And then Isaiah, he saw after his conviction and his confession, he then was converted. They touched his mouth with the tongs and the coals of the fire of heaven, and he was converted. And then after his conversion, God said, whom shall we send, and who will go for us? Now, Isaiah's the only one in the room. However, he has to make a free choice to accept the call of God on his life. And so God says, who will go for us? And Isaiah says, send me, I'll go. Now, this word send is a very powerful word in Hebrew. It's shaliach. Shaliach. In the Talmud says a man shaliach is as a man himself. It is a vice agent, a representative. It is someone who goes instead of the man. The Talmud says, and the Mishnah, the oral traditions of the rabbi, says that a man shaluach is as a man himself. And so a man shaluach was his representative, and he was so binding and so legal in his representation that a shaluach could actually marry in the man's stead. So if the man needed to get married, he couldn't be there, he could send his shaluach, and the shaluach could marry, and the marriage would be legal and binding. The only thing he could not do is consummate, but he could marry and make the marriage legal. And this is what God says to Isaiah, whom shall I send? And Isaiah says, send me, I'll go. And so when we talk then about Isaiah being called and commissioned, he's sent. So the preacher is the teller, the repeater. He's the one who tells you what God says. And our text is in the context of Paul's admonishment to Israel, and he's talking to them about the preacher. He starts off in chapter 10 saying, brethren, my heart and desire and prayer is that Israel may be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. He says they're zealous, zealous, the Greek term hot, they're boiling, they're on fire. They are hot for God, but it's not according to knowledge. It's not according to knowledge. And he says them being ignorant, agnoeo, the Greek term means without knowledge. Them being ignorant of God's dikaiosune, right standings or righteousness, them being ignorant of God's righteousness, they have gone about establishing their own righteousness, not submitting to the righteousness of God created in Christ Jesus. So he says that Israel is zealous and ignorant. They are on fire. But they're ignorant. Now, Israel's traditions were so burdensome that being religious was something of a serious nature. And Paul said, you're doing all of this to earn right standings with God, and you don't have it. And he goes on and he says, in essence, you've got to call upon the name of the Lord. If you're going to be saved, you're not going to be saved by what you do. You're going to have to be saved because you call on the name of the Lord. And he says, and everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord shall not be put ashamed. And they that call upon the Lord, whether they're Jew or Gentile, God would save them. And he says the only way God can deliver you is for you to call upon his name. But now he says, but the calling of his name is contingent. He says, how can they call upon them, him whom they've not believed? And how can they believe in him they've not heard? And how can they hear without a preacher? And how can he preach except he be sent? In essence, Paul says, you can't do nothing without the preacher. He says you can't call God without the preacher. It's the preacher that's going to help you to understand how to call on God. He says you can't just call on him any kind of way. The preacher is going to teach you how to call on God. So the preacher is responsible for your ability to call, because you won't call on God unless you believe in God, but you won't believe in God unless you hear about God. And you cannot hear about God without the preacher. You are what you are in God today because of the preacher. If it had not been for the preacher, you wouldn't even have the ability to call on God when you're sick. You wouldn't even have the ability to call on God when you're broke. You wouldn't have the ability to call on God when you're down. It's the preacher who taught you how to call on God. Today, many of you are sitting here and you got a sound mind and you got a will to go on, not because of what you've done. It's because you keep coming in this building and you listening to the preacher week after week. He's helping you with your burden. He's helping you with your children. He's helping you with your self-esteem. He's helping you with your value and your worth. He's helping you with your economics. He's helping you with your community perspective. He's helping you. It's his words that are continuously keeping you to go. Somebody ought to say, thank God for the preacher. Everybody point at Pastor Jamal Bryan and say, we thank God for the preacher. Yeah, you don't know how valuable the preacher is. Paul says, how can they hear without the preacher? And how can he preach except he be sent? I want you to know your man of God was sent here by God. You voted for him, but God sent him. You wouldn't have been able to vote for him if God didn't send him. It was the furthest thing from his mind. He never thought he was going to be here. He had a prosperous church in Baltimore. He had built from the ground, but God took him from one place to another place. You know why? Because God knew you needed a preacher. You needed somebody that could come in here and talk to you during this episode of your life. You needed somebody who had experienced what this preacher had experienced. Now Paul says something very powerful. He says, how can you hear without a preacher? And how can he preach except he be sent? Then he moves and says, how beautiful are the feet of them that preached the good news. Now, out of all of the body parts God could have chose to accentuate in this text, he chooses the feet. And I don't know if you looked at folk's feet lately. You know, feet are not a very beautiful sight. Sometimes feet can make the difference in the dating choice. Feet. You know, feet go through a whole lot. They bear the brunt of an undisciplined diet. They bear the brunt of not being able to afford a car. They get all kinds of mileage on them. And during this time, they walked the majority of the time with sandals. So the feet can get dirty and smelly, which speaks to the journey of the preacher. In order for the preacher to get to you, they've got to go through their own journey. And in order for them to get to you, they've got to experience their own set of frustrations, their own set of setbacks, their own set of fatigue. See, because the preacher got to go through in order to get to. The preacher cannot get to you unless they go through what they're going through, which means then the feet are only beautiful to those who appreciate the message. Because those that are waiting for the good news, the euangelion, the good news of the kingdom, they don't care about smelly feet. They don't care about foot fungus. They don't care about how dirty your feet are. They just want you to keep going. See, when you understand the importance of the preacher, you don't want nothing to stop them. If their feet get tired and they fall down, you say, get up, preacher, get up. get up. If they get discouraged, you say, get up, preacher, get up. If they feel like quitting, you say, don't quit, preacher, don't quit. Why? Because you got my mail in your bag. You got a message that God's trying to get to me. So I'm pulling for you. I'm praying for you. And I'm pushing you, because how can I hear without the preacher? It does me no good for you to fall and stay down. I need you to get up. I need you to be encouraged. I need you to fight through. Okay, yes, it's selfish. Yes, it's self-motivated. But you got mail in your bag that God is trying to get to me. And you can't take today off, because I need a word from the Lord. And my word from God is in your mailbag. Thus he says, thus he says, then faith come by hearing, which means if I don't hear from you, I can't have faith in God. So my connection to you is my connection to God. My faith is increased and built by what you deliver to me. My time is about up, so let me just say this. Then I'm gonna sit, because you've got to keep your preacher going. Come on, look to your neighbor and say, you got to keep your preacher going. Come on, say it like you mean it. Touch somebody that look like they love the pastor, they love the preacher, and say, we got to keep the preacher going. Come on. I just want to say three quick things that you've got to do to keep your preacher going. One is you got to honor him. You got to honor him. The Bible talks about the importance of honor. And it says that a prophet is not honored in his own hometown, which means you have to make sure that you don't take your preacher for granted. That you never let yourself get so close to him because of how congenial and how kind and how humble he is. You still have to understand that's God's man, and you got to honor him. You got to honor your preacher. And the Bible says that when they labor in doctrine and teaching, that they are worthy of double honor. So that means, and the word honor is timi, is what we get the word honorarium, which means to honor him means to bless him. And it says, and when it comes to your mind to bless him with one thing, then double that thing. Give him double honor. So if I'm going, if I say I'm gonna sow this in this anniversary, I'm gonna give him $500 for 5 years of stallion ministry and leadership. I'm gonna give him five, but then you say, I'm gonna give him double honor. I'm gonna give him 1,000 because of double honor. Then the Bible says, esteem him. Number two, esteem him very highly in love for his work's sake. Esteem him. This Greek term is only used one other time in the New Testament, and it's huper ek perisu. Huper means above, ek means out of above, perisu means superfluously, super abundantly above. So it says esteem him high. That means you don't have in your capacity the ability to give him the esteem that is commensurate with the value of his work. So that means you cannot esteem him high enough. You know, people that say, oh, they're making him a god. You can't make him a god. If you understood how valuable he was to you. It says esteem him. Now, that Greek term is only found one other place in the New Testament, and that's in Ephesians, and where it says, now to him who's able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that you ask or think. That's huper ek parisu. That's the same term. Now, we understand it in that context, but we don't understand it in the leadership context. That means then you have to esteem your leader, hooper, above, and then ek, out of above, and then parisu, superfluously, superabundantly above that, which means that's the kind of esteem you have. When the man of God walks out here on the stage, there ought to be a roar. There ought to be a reverence. There ought to be a shouting. Why? He got up again. He didn't let life hold him down. He didn't let the adversity of the faith discourage him. You have to esteem him. He gets esteemed in the environment. And then lastly, you have to sow into him, because he is the soil of God. He represents the soil of God. This is why Paul says, and my God shall supply all of your need according to his riches and glory. Why? Because you sowed into Paul. Paul said, you sowed into me. And when you sowed into me, you were sowing into the soil of God. The Levites didn't have soil. They were the soil of God. And so this is his fifth year of ministry. And he's brought you from $30 million of debt to $13 million. He fought that this wouldn't become a convention center. It would remain the house of God. He fought banks that tried to take over this ministry after you had sown and sown and sown, and your children, you've invested. And this place is supposed to be here for your children's children. And he led. It wasn't just any man that could have done that. And then he did it as a single man. My God. And as a single man, he pastored in such a way that kept your families together, that kept your children together, that kept your household together. God gave him that kind of wisdom as a single man. And how many of you know that one day God's gonna allow him to be rewarded on another level? He deserves to get his toes rubbed and his shoulder. He deserves to be able to go home and get a bubble bath. Y'all don't want to talk to me. Y'all can't have all the goods, and he don't. Yet you just come preach. He need a massage every now and then. That don't cost $250 an hour. Paul said, "Do I not have the right to have a believing wife?" Y'all don't want to talk to me. Come on, I'm just talking about the preacher. I'm talking about the preacher. Anything that keeps him going to get us our mail, that's what we want to do. We want to encourage the preacher. We want to be Aaron's and Ur's in this building. We want to keep his arms lifted, because we know when we keep his hands lifted, we know that God gives us victory. Listen, on this morning, this is his fifth year anniversary. Five, the number of grace. And God has graced you all. You getting ready to build 130 houses on your property. You've got a clinic. A clinic. Now, I don't know if y'all understand. Maybe that don't look like and sound like much to you all, but when I think, and up friends that I know, and we have sizable churches all over the country, and none of us got no clinic. Yeah. And we know about affordable housing projects on somebody else's property, but we don't know about 130 houses on our own property. And then he's not just talking about that ado, he's talking about five-star excellence. He's talking about being role models for other churches. And not to mention, who does that aside from New Birth that can sit up and say, we fed during the pandemic 1 million people? Who can say? I wish that was my testimony. This ministry is doing incredulous things that's being talked about all around the world by a man who's leading the way. And when you're leading the way, one of the things that you'll learn about success always brings haters. Don't nobody hate a loser. People hate winners. The higher you go up, the more folk fight you. The more folk scrutinize you. Folks, you know, it amplifies any of your inadequacies, any of your weaknesses. And don't you know that there's not a person in this building without inadequacy and weakness? That was not the litmus test God gave you in order to save you. By grace have we been saved. His mercy towards us and grace was not in vain. And can you imagine what the devil tries to do to stop him? To shut him up? He's on the front lines of social justice. He's on the front line. He's willing to put himself out there in places that other people are cowards in. They're afraid. They're afraid to step up and get involved. God has given you a great leader. He's a legend in his own right at 51, 52 years of age. And God gave him to you. And today, we want to appreciate him. We want him to know 5 years with New Birth. Can't nobody appreciate you like we do. We will not be the place where the prophet is without honor in his own home. We honor you. Come on, everybody, say, we honor you. And listen, let's honor him today, because there'll never be another 5 years for him. And we're so thankful. Do you know people die at all ages, saints? And then some people just quit at all ages. Don't you know when they told him $32 million, he could have said, well, you know, I'm going back to Baltimore. You know, because that's the first thing came to my mind. I'm out. You know, that's the first. You should have told me this. This wasn't in the contract. You withheld valuable information. There's something about deceptive trade practices up in this. I didn't know. And then I heard him talk about selling his house, living in Embassy Suites for 3 months. That would have broke me. I can't lie. That would have broke me. I didn't know. I sold my house. You got me here. And I sold my house. And then after I sold my house, then you said, well, we're going to do it like we said we were, but not yet. Then I'd have smelled the devil all in that. You know, and the devil is a lie. But he sensed God and said, if I suffer with him, I will also reign with him. And I don't know what any other anniversary and celebration is going to be, if he'll even have another one. None of us know that. We don't even know if we'll be here for a 6 year. But this year, if it's our last year, we want to make it the best year that he's ever had. Listen, I'm going to ask for at least 100 people to sow a seed of $500 celebrating his fifth year. And then there's some of you that's going to do double honor. You'll double that. And listen, I want him to feel that honor. And wherever you are, if you're one of those folk, and they're going to give you an envelope, but I want you to come to this altar right now, because I want him to see his honor in this building. I want you to come. You said, I'm sowing. I want you to sow. And I want you to know, the Bible says, let he who is taught the word share all good things with him who teaches the word. For God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sow, that shall he also reap. God's going to bless you for encouraging the man of God, honoring the man of God. Wherever you are, I want you to come. I want you to come to the altar. Come, I want you to come. Amen. I want him to see us coming. Come on, come on. We're not contemplating. I want us coming. Just want you to come. You said, I'm going to sow. I'm going to sow. They're giving envelopes. I'm going to sow a seed of 500. I want you to come. I'm going to sow. Come on, I'm waiting for you. I know sometimes we got to pray and fast for 2 minutes, but I'm waiting for you to come. God, we appreciate our shepherd. And I know for me, I've been doing this 39 years. This is my 39th year. Next year, I'll be 65. I've been doing this since I was 24. And I'm not a child of the church. I'm a child of the streets. So I was born and raised in the heathen environment. And so I don't have bishop this and bishop that. But I kept ministry number one in my life when I was called to ministry. And I do what I do because God has called me to do it. I don't do what I do because people appreciate me. And in fact, the only time of the year, only time that I even think about appreciation is doing celebrations like this. And for some reason, when this kind of thing happens, then I become a little sensitive because I want to see who encourages me during this time. I don't care about any other time of the year. I don't. But since they say we're going to celebrate, who's celebrating? Listen, those of you that say, man of God, I would love to do 500, but I've done something else, but I'm asking you to do this as a double honor. If you can do 250, I want you to come. Come. I want you to come. I want him to see us going over and above. How many of you know that he goes over and above all the time? He goes over and above all the time. If you're going to sow 250, I want you to come. Come, come, come. Come, come, beloved. Come, come. Because you appreciate that faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. And I can't even get faith without my preacher. And preacher, I want you to know, before we walk out here, this altar is going to be jam-packed with people sowing and showing you their support. I want you to come. Those that are sowing 250, amen. 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 Come on. Come on. Keep coming. Amen. Come on. Come on, come on, come on. I've already done something. Yeah, well, go over and above. Go over and above. Because what you make happen for others, God in turn will make happen for you. You need somebody to go over and above for you. I want you to come. I want you to come. Wherever you are, I want you to come. I want you to come. Say, man of God, I'm going to do 250. I want you to come. Come wherever you are. Come on. They're still coming. Come on. Come on. Amen. Some of you trying to do it on your device. Do it on your device up here. Because we want the man of God to see us honor him on the 5th anniversary. On the 5th. We know many of you have already done something, but we want to honor him specially in this service. In this service. If you're here and you say, man of God, I'm going to do a seed of 125. I can do that. I'm going. Will you come? Come on. Come on. I'm coming down your street. Come on. Come on. Let's bless the man of God. Come on. Somebody say, you just heard. You just said my number. That was my number. That was my number. I knew God had said that. Come. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. There's some of you. You've been waiting for me to say 100. Come on. Where you are. Come on. That's right. The altars are getting full now. Come on. Come on. Amen. Amen. This is his day. Is this his day? This is time. On your birthday, what you expect? Now, you know, my birthday is on Christmas. You know, man, that sucks. I'm telling you, it sucks. For 60-some years, it sucks. Now, but when people come to my house on Christmas, it's just automatic. I don't know why. When they ring the doorbell, I let them in. I look down at their hands. I don't know. It's an expectation because my birthday. I just feel like, you know, somebody's got a birthday gift for me. Listen, you said I'm going to sow 100. Come on, fill these aisles. I want you to come. There's some that say, man of God, the closest I could do in this season in my life to 5 was 50. I was going to sow a seed of $50 a day representing his 5 years of ministry. Will you come? Will you come? You said, I'm going to sow a seed of $50. There you go. Come on. Come on. We almost there. I want to see those lines back there. Amen. Come on, because this is a gift from Dr. Jamal Bryant. Amen. He's not just any pastor. He's your pastor, and he's a front runner in the body of Christ. And we thank God for him. Listen, those of you that say, man of God, I don't have a number. You haven't said my number, but I want to give. I want to give. I want to give. Well, listen, you said, I'm going to give. I want you to come on, get in that line, and then I'm going to bless these gifts, and I'm going to ask God to release a harvest as you sow into the man of God, because you're keeping the man of God encouraged. You're keeping the man of God coming. Listen, some of us, we need to make up for them 3 months in the embassy suites. Amen. Listen. Listen, come on. And listen, I'm gonna bless these gifts, and then you're gonna drop them in the receptacle, and amen. Listen, we sing songs for an hour, amen, and we don't have no problem. We shout for an hour, you know, and we're gonna give, and we're gonna do that. But lift those seeds up now towards heaven, no matter what it is. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for these gifts, these seeds. These are special seeds. These seeds are assigned to the man of God. They are to be an encouragement to him for the work that he's done in the families, in the individual lives, the children and the youth, and the community of Atlanta, Georgia. And God, the reformation that he is leading here, we pray now, God, as they sow into his life, that an overflow of what you're doing in his life will touch their lives. God, let the favor that rests on their leader. You said the anointing flows from Aaron's head down to his beard, to his body. Let there be an overflow now, God, because they're sowing into the life of the man of God. Now, God, we speak blessings over these gifts. We speak supernatural harvest over these seeds. In Jesus' name, we thank God. Amen. Come on. Come on. Come on. Bring those seeds. Come on.
Oh, ooh. You ain't. Oh, you ain't seen nothing. No. Bring those seeds all over the building. See nothing. Oh, see nothing. Come on, everyone, if you, amen, everyone's giving. Amen. I want everybody to stand to your feet and let's receive. Amen. Amen. Clap your hands and give Pastor Jamal a round of applause.
Come on, let's thank God for Dr. Carson. Aren't we blessed by the gift, the anointing, the assignment that is on his life? If you received a word, it blessed your heart. Will you just clap your hands and give God praise? In the sanctuary, and to all of those who are watching online, listen, do me a favor, nudge the person beside you and tell them, stay right where you are, stay right where you are. There is more to come. Tell somebody else, don't move now, don't move. Don't move and get hurt. Something good is still happening in the sanctuary. The Bible is clear, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. How many of us can feel the freedom of God in the house today? Aren't we just thankful for all that God is doing, has done, and is getting ready to do? As the musicians and as the minstrels continue to play behind me, I just want to open up an opportunity for us to thank God for the preacher through the commitment of doing a couple of things. Some of you are saying right now, I needed that word because I am at a place in my life where I need repentance. Where I'm at a place in my life where I want to turn from some things and I want to give my life to Jesus. Some of you are saying, I have never committed my life to Jesus. And today, after hearing that, I want to give my life to the Lord. Some of you are saying, hey, listen, I know Jesus, but I have fell away. I have strayed away. I have stepped back from the course. Hey, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you even in this moment to make the decision to say, God, I am so blessed that a righteous man can fall seven times and still get back up again. Is there somebody in the room that can thank God that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us? For those who don't know that church lingo, all that means is God loves you past what you've done. Some of you are saying, hey, this is my first, third, tenth time at New Birth, but I never made New Birth a home. I've seen what New Birth has done on the news. I've read in the newspaper. I've seen the post, but I hadn't done anything yet. But after hearing this man of God and after seeing the testimonies and after hearing from Dr. Brian from afar and up close, I definitely need a pastor, and I want Dr. Brian to be that person for me. If you fit in one of these three categories, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to grab your wallet, grab your purse, grab your things, tell your girlfriend, tell your homeboy, I'm about to make a move. Look at the person beside you and say, somebody's about to make a move. Somebody's about to make a move. And I want to encourage all of those who are getting ready to make this move. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed, because we've all been at the place where we had to leave that seat and come right down the aisle and say, Lord, what must I do to be saved? Do I have any witnesses in the room? Now listen, this is what's getting ready to happen. The musicians are getting ready to play. New Birth is getting ready to clap. And when I release you by faith, you're getting ready to come down to this altar to say, I'm ready to get saved. I'm ready to recommit. I'm ready to make New Birth my home. On the count of three, one, two, three. Come on, let's begin clapping. Come on, let's begin rejoicing like somebody is coming, like somebody is ready to make a decision. Where are you right now? You may be online. If you're online, I want you to write in grownewbirth.org. We want this place to be a place that not only you go to, but you grow in. God bless you, sister. God bless you. God bless you, my man. Come on, New Birth. Let's clap our hands and give God glory. I see you coming. I see you coming. God bless you, daughter. You haven't seen nothing yet. Your best days are before you. New Birth, clap your hands like you're excited about it. Come on, put your hands on it. You haven't seen nothing. God bless you. Come on, I see him coming down the side with baby in hand. God bless you. He's doing something in the families. God bless you. Look at all these wonderful people who have come. I believe that God is sending some more men today. Come on, New Birth family. Let's thank God for the fellas who are ready to make the decision, who are ready to take the step, who are ready to go forward, who are ready to move into the things of God. Will you do me a favor? Look at the person beside you and say, I'm glad I sat beside you. I'm glad I sat beside you. I'm glad I sat beside you. Tell them. And you smell good too. You smell good. I don't know if it's the fragrance of worship or the perfume of cologne, but you smell great. You smell great. Now look them in the eye and say, can I ask, God bless you. Ask them a question. Say, can I ask you a question? Have you given your life to Jesus? Tell them, no shade, no judgment. Just a question. Have you given your life to Jesus? Ask the next question. Do you have a church home? Do you have a church home? Now, whatever they say, if they stuttered, if they looked up, grab them by the hand and just pull them. Come on down here. Yeah. All right. Come on, 30 more seconds. Come on, let's just lift it up one more time. If that's you, I'm speaking to you. I want you to come on down right now. God bless you. God bless you. May the Lord keep you. May heaven smile upon you. Hey, listen, family, thanks so much for trusting the man of God that ministered the word of God. And thank you so much. We can bless God for that. Oh, shucks. Yes, sir. I love it. You snuck up on me. Yeah. They still coming. We got three more. Only God can do it. Hey, that's what's up. To God be the glory for the many things he is doing in your life. Hey, I want you to get in the car. And when you get in the car, I want you to write this date down, because this is the best day of your entire life. And we are believing that the best is yet to come. We're getting ready to release you. And when we release you, some individuals are going to take you into a private room to ensure that your ministry needs are met. So if you're seeking prayer, prayer of salvation, if you desire the gift of the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in tongues, if you need to talk through some things, we are there to minister to you. I don't want you to see this as a place that you just go. I want you to see this as a home. And there are many rooms that we have in this home to serve all of your needs. How many of you all know that's what New Birth is all about? Hey, my name is Kylie's. But that is your senior pastor right there, Dr. Jamal Bryant. Hey, New Birth family, make some noise for them as they go. Let's celebrate God. You can go even now. Follow the directions of this sign. To God be all of the glory. Hey, New Birth family and friends, for those who are in the room and watching online, you may be seated. Take your hands off the keyboard and watch this.
Pastor Bryant, in 5 years, changed the trajectory of my life after years of loss.
Being at New Birth, we were always taught, you know, we are here to conquer, you know, we are here to call to conquer. And just while being here with Dr. Bryant, he's allowed us to, one, get our strength back.
He's encouraged me to build a deeper relationship because he sets an example. And he also gives us notes. He gives us, he actually gives us scriptures to go to. And he gives us a blueprint on what we need to be closer to God.
When Dr. Bryant came and his style of teaching, preaching, and his ability to reach those individuals out there in the world was a way to resonate with us. So therefore, when we saw the unchurched showing up, thing that we had prayed for, that it was like, okay, something is different happening within the ministry. And so we stayed committed also.
Pastor Bryant has such a unique way of vision. He's such a visionary. And he has come to New Birth and has really set me on the path to walk into my destiny. There are so many things that I kind of knew, but because he came here to set the vision and to make it real plain and clear, I am now walking in my destiny.
Virtually, I started listening to Pastor Bryant online every Tuesday night, master class, group therapy, Sunday service. And it put me in a place where I needed to be to stay balanced as a mother, as a Christian.
I would like to thank Pastor for being a beacon of hope and comfort in my life.
I say the word I want to use about Dr. Bryant is that he cares about people, and he is able to resonate and articulate that power of caring about people, no matter what walk of life they come from, that they are welcome at New Birth.
That Saturday when they opened the health care in the community, we was there on that day, and I was impressed. I was touched by what Pastor Bryant is doing in the community, and that really touched my heart.
He's doing a lot for the community. Yeah, even he does for the holidays. He's giving away, you know, turkeys. He's giving away gifts for Christmas. So Pastor Bryant's always giving. He's always giving back to the community, and I love that about our church.
Happy anniversary, Dr. B.
Happy anniversary, Dr. Bryant.
Happy anniversary, Dr. Bryant.
Happy anniversary, Pastor Bryant.
Happy anniversary, Dr. Bryant.
Happy anniversary.
Happy anniversary, Dr. Bryant.
Happy anniversary, Dr. Bryant.
Happy anniversary, Dr. Bryant. We love you.
New Birth family, for all those who are in the sanctuary and all those around the world, without further ado, let's stand on our feet. And I want us with a thunderous shout begin to roar as we welcome to the stage, now going towards 6 years of pastorate, that God is blessing him in a phenomenal 5 years of ministry. The one, the only, the incomparable, Dr. Jamal Harrison. Let's lift it up around the world. Brian!
Listen, would you all just mind staying for a few more minutes while we honor our pastor? Is that okay? Can I have all of our elders and our deacons and our ministers just come around the altar? And if you're in the audience, we want you to keep standing this morning. Listen, I want to say this. Our pastor never asks us for anything for himself. Amen. Any requests he have, it's always to advance our ministry and take us further. And so today, Pastor, we just want to take a minute to honor you. We are grateful for your life, your legacy. We thank you for your public and private sacrifices. We will never know the weight and the burden that you carry as a result of this cross that you have taken on. We are grateful for your yes. Because of your yes, our whole lives have been transformed. And so there are many things that we probably could get for you, but today we really wanted to give you something symbolic of our love for you and our belief for where the Father is taking you the next 5 years. And so as Pastor Ross and Pastor Lemons comes, we want to just adorn you. Hallelujah. We wanted to adorn you with something that speaks, yes, to the heart of who you are. And we pray that as you wear it, that the Spirit of the Lord leads you, that you are overshadowed by the Lord, that He goes before you, that He anchors you, that He keeps you, that He strengthens you, that He blesses you, that He makes His face to shine upon you, that He enlarges your territory, that your body would be healthy, your mind would be sound, that no good thing will He withhold from you, and that this will be the happiest time in your life. Listen, can we just stretch our hands to our pastor? Hallelujah. We're going to have Elder Broderick come and pray.
And so, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we thank you for being our God, for being the Holy One, the Righteous One, for being the God that eliminates and destroys cancer, but for also being the God that eliminates dead. Now, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we thank you for this gift that you have given New Birth in the body of Jamal Harrison Bryan. Today, Father, we give him back to you, and we say, more grace, Father, more grace, Father, more grace, oh God, in the name of the Lord Jesus. We thank you that the leader in him is built upon the rock. We thank you that the man that he is built upon the rock. We thank you that the father that he is built upon the rock. We thank you that the revolutionary that he is built upon the rock. And so though the rains come, though the winds blow, though life may life, we thank you that the man of God won't break. We prophesy to his mind that he has the mind of Christ. So new levels and waves of creativity and ingenuity manifest now. We prophesy to his back. May his back not break. May his back not bend. May his back not bow. For you are the God who is the one that lifts every burden. So God, in the name of the Lord Jesus, we ask that you give Jamal Bryan your burden, that you give him your yoke, in the name of the Lord Jesus, for they are both easy. We prophesy to his hands. May his hands be productive. May his hands produce. May his hands build. Build, builder, unto the glory of God, in the name of the Lord Jesus. And we prophesy to his feet. We prophesy to his feet. May his feet run through troops. May his feet leap over walls. May his feet not be moved from seats of righteousness, in the name of the Lord Jesus. We thank you, Father, for the grace of Nathan that is on his life. May the arms of nations open up. May the arms of nations open up and warmly receive Dr. Jamal Harrison Bryan. May he be filled with the counsel of God. May he be filled with the spirit of truth. May he be filled with godly wisdom, in the name of the Lord Jesus. And for those of us that are in agreement with the prayer, can you release your praise right here? Come on here, release your praise. Father, we thank you for our pastor. We thank you for our leader. No weapon formed against them will prosper. No weapon formed.
Hallelujah. We have one more special presentation for Pastor this afternoon. We're going to welcome right now the director of the African American Textile Museum that we have right here in our building, Sister Hilson, and some of our women of wisdom.
Dr. Bryan, I just wanted to say thank you. Thank you so much for everything that you've done. On behalf of the African Textile Museum, who you gave a home, and I really love you, I really do. And on behalf of the Wild Women, our sisters here, come step up, Queen Mother. These sisters and I, this is the artwork that I did especially for you, because Martin gave us the dream, but you have given us the vision, and we appreciate you. Thank you so, so much.
To my pastor, I love so much, and I don't mind telling him that I'm never ashamed of a word that he says, because he gives us history, He gives us the future. He gives us the present. And the word is true because it comes from the Lord. And we thank you. Continue to do his will, not man, because they didn't call you. From the Women of Wisdom.
Oh, thank you so much. Thank you.
Will you all give another round of applause for our incredible pastor? Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. You can return back to your seats. Praise the Lord. In lieu of just a few announcements, I just want to remind you that our textile museum is open. You're more than welcome to tour it. Amen. It is in where we used to have our library. They have transformed it into our textile museum, as well as this Tuesday at 7:30. Somebody say group therapy. Come on, say it one more time. Group therapy. Amen. We hope to see you Tuesday night. We've been having incredible moments with our pastor. And also one more thing, if you have a card that you received from an usher and you didn't get a chance earlier to bring it to the altar, you are more than welcome to place your card at the altar. Can we scream real big one more time for our pastor, Dr. Jamal Harrison Bryant?
Bless the Lord. Come on. Bless the Lord. Would you help me thank God for all of our team and staff who helped us pull this together? Come on, let's give God glory for them. I am so appreciative for the privilege of being able to share. Would you help me thank God for Pastor Dana Carson, who came from Houston, Texas? He never leaves his church on Sunday morning. I need you to do me a favor. He has written over 200 books. Most of them are in academic circles. They're not for lay people, but he's brought about 20 of his books today. He's signing books in the library. We are leaders, and because we're leaders, we're readers. And so I'm asking you to please go buy a couple of those books. Let them know how appreciative you are that he came to be with us on today. Help me thank God for Sister Kathy, who sang today. Didn't she do an amazing job. Tuesday night, my dear friend and brother is coming from Miami, Florida. Bishop-elect Tori Phillips is going to be with us Tuesday night. And so I desperately want to see all of you with us on Tuesday night for our group therapy. Had not today been absolutely amazing? It's been amazing. I'm honored our mayor is worshiping with us on today. Mayor Jasmine Cabo, would you give God a hand clap of praise? Thank you so much. You all are not clapping appropriately. Mayor Jasmine Cabo is singularly responsible. We didn't have what it took in terms of our zoning and permit to build 150 houses, and she walked us all the way through the process. What should have taken 2 years to get done, she did it in a matter of months. I need you to help me thank God. Come on, y'all got to do better than that. Amazing gift. She has been a long-standing friend to our ministry. Would you lift those hands as high as you can? Thank you for the seeds that you've sown. Thank you for the gift that you have been to me and my family. As of August, I'm paying for 3 college tuitions. So thank you for helping me so very much. Now my checks are going to FAMU, Spelman, and Hampton. Yes. Yes. Amen. And my middle daughter, Naomi, is this is my last check. She's graduating with her master's degree in public health from the University of Maryland this coming June. Amen. So thank you. Y'all better tell the people thank you. Thank you for helping us to get through it. I'm appreciative. And looking forward to the next 5 years together. Lift up that hand as high as you can. Repeat after me, walk with God, and he'll walk with me. Talk with God, and he'll talk with me. Listen to God, and he'll listen to me. Love God, because he first loved me. Now, this is y'all's new little cousin. She walks with me when y'all are out of town. Just to keep me company. And she got on a dress for the occasion. You look good, boo. Thank you. Lift that hand as high, high. Come on, lift it higher than that. Because I'm believing New Birth is going to go higher than we've ever been before. Together, we're going to change the world and we're going to impact the culture. Now, unto him who's absolutely able to do anything but fail, may God make you sleepless until you help somebody. May God make you restless until you help yourself. May God irritate you until you have enough sense to worship him. And may God bless you until you have to give stuff away. Henceforth, now and forevermore. And the blessed people of God said, amen. God bless you. Your pastor loves you. I need to see all of you on Tuesday night.